Thank you, Ray, for agreeing to do this video interview with me. Let's start by catching up. What have you been up to lately?
Well, my last few projects have been involved with a healthcare insurance company in Michigan, which I won't name, but 2 years ago they engaged me to work with five teams who were going to simultaneously work on creating a mega human performance system in the human resources area. And the subsystems that we were working on included leadership development, performance management, succession management, business knowledge, and rewards and recognition. We created five teams to work on each of these five initiatives, and we created a series of design and planning meetings in which all these teams were working simultaneously and interactively with each other. So we created a mega systems architecture where we identified all the important inputs and outputs of each of these five subsystems and made sure that they were all integrated and worked together. It was a very, I thought, innovative approach, and clients were very happy with the result. And then we rolled into a second wave of activity, which was detailed design and implementation planning for each of those five initiatives. I had an opportunity to be involved with two of those. I helped design the leadership development system that came out of that. The leadership development system embraced a menu of different learning strategies, some of which were going to workshops, but most of them were on the job learning with mentoring and coaching by other senior managers. But the mentoring and coaching was not just free form. It was all based on a performance model. They called it a leadership profile, so that if you were a middle manager in a particular department, you had a leadership profile that said what your mission and responsibilities and typical tasks were. And we had created a series of modules for structured on-the-job learning for each of those kinds of responsibilities and tasks. When you do it in a structured on-the-job learning way, it can always be customized to each individual's job. So you have a generic model for what a middle manager does, but you're doing mass customization because of the structured on-the-job coaching approach to teaching it, so that we're customizing it to what each individual has to do in their world. The other project that I got involved in was the business knowledge project. I have never been involved in a business knowledge project before. I always kind of thought, well, that's kind of interesting. Yeah, people need some business knowledge. But getting involved in this, I realized how important it is for everybody in an organization to have contextual knowledge about the business that they're participating in, who the customers are, what the products and services are that are offered, how those are offered, who the competition is, how each person's job or department plays into the business. We created a menu of business knowledge categories, and I worked with a woman who was a virtual encyclopedia of knowledge for the business, and we roughed out a content hierarchy for the business knowledge curriculum. And then the team took this menu around to the senior executives in the company and had them edit it and establish ownership for content areas. And the owners then identified subject matter experts who would be responsible for working with the team to develop the content for the cells. We used, in our delivery methods, we used a variety of different delivery methods, but one of the more interesting and innovative ones was to use a wiki methodology for creating an online encyclopedia of different levels of business knowledge, so that people, if they wanted to know about a particular competitor, for example, could go on there, find out about this competitor, what their business model is, the kind of products and services they have, competitive advantages, and disadvantages, all that stuff created by a cadre of subject matter experts who were identified by the knowledge group.
Excellent.
We also had a entry onboarding business knowledge system for new employees coming into the business that augmented the orientation program for new employees, but was very focused on specific business knowledge that the business leaders decided everybody had to have. And that was not just handing people knowledge, there's a mentoring coaching approach to that so that everybody really got handled through acquiring some of this important business knowledge over the first couple months that they were in the company. And there were some other innovative things in there, but the whole idea here was that we had these five interventions, leadership development, business knowledge, performance management, succession management, rewards and recognition. We created an integrated macro design, and then we went ahead and did detailed design and implementation for the five individual initiatives, all the time paying attention to the integration among those five subsystems. I've been preaching for many years about how these human resources systems need to integrate and rely on common things like a common description of the work that people have to do, so that people who are doing recruiting, people who are doing performance management, people who are doing succession management, people who are doing training, they're all operating off the same menu of what these people need to do and what they need to know in order to do it. This is the first time I've had a chance to actually do that with a major corporation, so it was fun and rewarding.
Tell us a little bit about any publications, any books or articles that you've recently published and or are working on.
The most recent publication is a book on how to develop an employee qualification / certification program that Guy Wallace and I wrote together, and it is published on our websites and available to anyone who wants it for free by just looking it up on our website. Basically, it deals with the issue that we have employees who are doing critical, important, perhaps dangerous work, and we want to make sure that the employees are capable of performing that work to a standard. And we based this book on work that we had done in the past with the Alaskan pipeline and with the oil companies in Prudhoe Bay to create qualification systems for their maintenance technicians and operators, and which we went in and identified all the work that people had to do in specific tasks, created a set of qualification tests which were on the job administered tests administered by qualified subject matter experts, checking that people were actually able to perform the work to a standard. And then there's a whole administrative system that we have to set up to make sure that the tasks are kept evergreen, the tests are kept evergreen, people have a way to complain if they think they're being unfair, and escalate if they're being unfairly tested. So that was my last interesting publication endeavor. I'm being encouraged by some people to update my book on strategic planning for training and development, and I don't know if I'm going to do that or not, but I might.
Okay. You've been a member of the society for a great number of years here. Can you tell us about your history? What was your entree into the society, and what kinds of volunteering you've done, and other activities that you've been involved in?
Sure. My background, I started as an engineer with Bell Laboratories back in the 60s and became an engineering manager at AT&T. And I was, as an engineering manager, I was largely responsible for architecting complex systems of one kind or another. And when we set up an engineering training center in the late 60s, I got sent out in 72 to be sort of the systems architect for the education center. Well, I didn't know anything about education except what I learned in college, right? And when I got to the education center, I found that we had people involved who were called instructional technologists, things like that, and I had to re-educate myself about the whole training and education business before I could make any sense out of architecting the business. And my boss, whose name was Chuck Sainer, suggested that I go talk to some other people that we had in the Bell system who were very deep into this, and he sent me to meet people like Harry Shoemaker and Fred Wells, who were important players in what was then NSPI. Harry was the director of educational research for AT&T, so Harry had sort of an academic research bent, and Fred Wells was the manager of plant training for AT&T. Now, plant training served a population of 250,000 plant technicians in 22 telephone companies. And Harry and Fred at that time were engaged in something that I think is still an amazing initiative. It was called the Plant Fair Share Program. The 22 operating telephone companies each had their own plant training departments, each of whom had created their own comprehensive training curriculums, most of which were not judged to be very effective. So they formed this plant training advisory board. Fred Wells was the chairman of that board, and Harry Shoemaker was the human performance technology advisor to the board. And one of the things that the board struggled with in its early inception was that we're all creating our own independent curriculums. None of them are very good. We ought to come up with a way that we can develop high quality learning materials and share them, but none of us trusts anyone else to do a good job. And so Harry and Fred came up with the training development standards. Training development standards broke down the training process into a series of phases. The first phase was a pre-project study in which you had to scope out the problem, identify what the end competencies or skills were that people needed, and identify the value to the business, and create a project plan for developing the training. The next phase, and at the end of the pre-project study, the pre-project study report was brought to the Plant Training Advisory Board, and they approved the project to go forward and approved one of the 22 companies to undertake the project. The company that undertook the project had to agree to abide by the standards. So the standards required that you go through a job analysis, an instructional design, a development phase, testing phase, and implementation phase. Each of these phases required a report and a gate point, and the board approved before you went to the next phase. So this is how they created a quality control system that assured each of them that if they took courses that were created by the other companies, that they would be high quality and usable in their company. Now, I have to say that underlying this was the fact that all of these 22 companies were implementing the same equipment and technology that was created by Bell Laboratories and Western Electric and implemented in the telephone companies. So they had the same equipment, the same methods, and the same technology to deploy. They just didn't have the same training until the Plant Training Advisory Board and the standards. Terrific intervention. Harry and Fred brought me into ISPI. They said to me, if you're going to be engaged in this field and be a leader, you have to come to ISPI and learn this human performance technology, because that's how you really do it. And so that was my introduction to ISPI. And when I first arrived at ISPI in the middle 70s, I realized that it was full of AT&T and Bell System people and their consultants. It's not that presence is not felt today the way it was then, but it was very interesting to meet a lot of people from my own corporation. At that time, AT&T had 1 million employees. We were the largest corporation in the country. Since then, ISPI has been my professional home. I've come to almost every international conference since 1978. I've been a presenter at most of the conferences, participated in a number of other ways, one of which was to facilitate a group of people that identified communities of practice and work that into the whole society infrastructure. I'm excited about the future of ISPI. I'll keep coming even after I've long stopped working the field.
Let's talk a little bit about some of the part of this legacy series is to try to capture stories and memories of members of other members.
Yeah.
So whether it's a personal anecdote or whether it's something that you learned specifically from other members, go back in the memory banks here and tell us about some of those folks and what you may have learned from them or an interesting fact about them personally.